Welcome back. So now we're going to talk about how do we do duration estimates. We want to be able to estimate durations for particular activities or tasks. And we also want to be able to estimate the entire duration for an overall project. And so that's what we're going to talk about today. So let's get started. So we have to look at different sources to get estimates for these types of activities. Different types of things. Experience is probably one of the best ways to get fairly accurate estimates. So somebody who's actually done this type of project before, who's coded a similar scale project before, you know, whatever that is, or if you can get expert opinions on that. Hopefully you have some of that in-house. Sometimes you don't. So the less experience you have in doing some of the work, the more error there's probably going to be in your estimating of time. So that's why it's always good to get some other opinions of people who've been there, done that, on how long it's going to take. A famous story for that is my wife thinks every project at our house takes 3 days. I swear. So we had a decking that was supposed to take 3 days that we were going to build. 6 weeks later, I think we finally got to the 3 days. So be careful whose opinion you take. Make sure it is an expert. Okay. The other thing that we use that they found is more useful than a normal distribution is something called a beta distribution. We'll talk more about that. What a beta distribution has is something that we call the most likely factor. So this is what we think our best estimate is. However, it may not be right. Things happen. Things change. I mean, look at COVID. Things have happened there. So you also have a pessimistic estimate. What do you think is the worst case scenario that it could be? And then you have an optimistic side. Say, what do you think is the best case scenario that something can be? So we have these three things that we're going to use in a beta distribution, which is different than normal. We'll talk about that in a second. We're also looking at the variance of duration. So based upon these three numbers, we're going to calculate some fudge room, some wiggle room, say, you know, there's a lot of wiggle room in what we think that will actually happen. So duration variance is really the square of the standard deviation. So, and this is for a sample standard deviation. So we calculate, or duration variance is calculated by taking the pessimistic view, the B time. So let's say we think something's going to take 10 weeks of worst case scenario, and say our optimistic scenario is that it'll take a month or 4 weeks. So it'd be 10 weeks minus the 4 weeks, could be 6 divided by 6, would actually be 1 squared, which would be 1. So that's how you can calculate per activity a variance. And I'll show another video later on how to go through all these things. Then there's the time estimate for a particular activity. And this is where we're going to use, again, the optimistic, most likely, and pessimistic. So it's actually a weighted average if you look at the equation carefully. We weight the optimistic with a value of 1. The most likely, we weight times 4. So it's like having m plus m plus m plus m. And then we weight the pessimistic with a value of 1. So because we have 6 elements, 6 weights, we divide it by 6. So it's just like taking the average divided by 6. But we just have 4 times the weight for the most likely. And that gives us a time estimate for each and every activity that we want to do. So, okay, assumes a range of 1/6 because we're actually using the divided by 6 parameter. Okay, so when we look at the difference, like, okay, why are we doing this? Why do we do this beta distribution thing versus a normal distribution? Well, let's take a look at the difference. A normal distribution is equally weighted on the left and right sides. It's centered around the average, which is the mean. In a normal distribution, the mean is also the same thing as the median and the mode. They're all centered, meaning each side is perfectly symmetrical. Great in an idealistic sense, not so great when you're looking at variables that you can't account for where things can change very quickly. A beta distribution isn't shaped symmetrically, it's asymmetric. So, and oftentimes when we're dealing with projects or things where things can get longer than we expect, it typically leverages more on the long side or the pessimistic side. So that's what's kind of shown here. If you notice the M, the most likely, because we weighted it four times, that becomes the mode. But it is not the same thing as the mean. And even though it may be halfway in between, it is not the average by any stretch. So this is where the big difference comes between the beta distribution. And instead of using the full distribution calculation, we're shortcutting it with the calculations that we have here, which are pretty good estimates with the A, the B, and the M. So this is how we develop our estimates. So we have a spreadsheet here with a list of different activities. So this is just a project came up with called XKids. The duration of our units is weeks, and I'm including this spreadsheet in this section in the mode. So you can download the spreadsheet and use it yourself as a template, and throw in your own activities and your own descriptions, all those kinds of things. So here we've got a description of all the activities or the tasks we've got, A through H. So everything from signing the contract to presenting to the customer. It's that same design I showed you in the last lecture. So our optimistic numbers are the shortest times we think we can perform each of these activities. Most likely is, what do we think it's probably going to end up being? And our pessimistic is when things go wrong, it could be as bad as this or take as long as this. Now, just as a gut check, make sure that your most likely numbers are between your optimistic and your pessimistic. They don't have to be exactly in the middle, but they have to be somewhere in between. Otherwise, that doesn't make any sense. So the things we have to calculate then are the time estimate and the duration variance. So for the time estimate, for example, on E, develop the presentation, we have our optimistic, our most likely, and our pessimistic, which is 2 weeks, 4 weeks, and 5 weeks. So we do our calculation, 2 weeks plus 4 times 4 weeks plus 5 weeks divided by 6, we get a value of 3.83333 some odd weeks. You want to round that up. Now in this case, it's an obvious roundup because it's closer to 4 than it is to 3. However, my suggestion to you is whenever you have a number that's greater than a number, particularly if it's not that close, that you always round up. Why? Because it's a more conservative estimate and favors the planner and the person doing the work rather than something that you're pitching to. Because if things do go worse or other things that were unforeseeable happen, you've got a little bit of a buffer. Otherwise, if you round down, you're actually making it harder for you to perform to what you say you can do. So my advice to you is to round up. Some construction areas where things are really tight and maybe you're competing against a lot of people, that's tougher to do. Maybe you can trim on some things. But in general, I would put rounding up in there. Either that or you add buffers later on to your overall schedule. You can calculate the duration variance, same thing. It's the pessimistic minus the optimistic divided by 6 again, then you square it, and we get a variance for this activity of 0.25. And you need to do this for each and every activity. Everything in your work breakdown structure list has to have this type of calculation so you can have an estimate, which is why I included that table. So you guys have those calculations that you can either do. I have a video where I show you guys how to do it, but you can embed the numbers, and I have the estimates, then I showed a roundup column just so you can see the difference. And then also the duration variance, which here I'm only using 2 significant digits. Maybe you can go 3, it just depends upon how close you want to get. And just for a good measure, I added up all of the time estimates for a total duration estimate. So this shows 47 weeks. Now, that is not the estimate you want to use, because remember, in this network, some things were in parallel, some things were in series. So this just adds up every single activity as if it were sequential, but that is not the case. So it should not take 47 weeks, but this gives us our upper bound if that's what was going on. But that's not a number you should use. So what we really need to do is determine the critical path. So to do that, I've actually created some separate videos, and these are more by hand. And the reason I'm doing this is so that you can understand intuitively how to do the calculations yourself. One, you're going to have to do it on a quiz. There it is. A little hint. But two, any type of network diagram, whether you have software or not, you can understand how the process works. You understand what's behind the algorithm. And once you get used to it, it's actually relatively simple. Secondly is, I will show you in another video, after you build your network diagram, find your critical path, also how to do it with software like Microsoft Project or Project Libre, because it actually can calculate those things for you. However, you still have to have your time estimates. That's why I created that separate spreadsheet so that you can do those calculations, so that you can then put those estimates into something like Microsoft Project. So we'll talk about the critical path in those videos, but let's assume we've found the critical path. So we have our network, and one simple way to find the critical path, which you can do in easy networks, in more complicated networks, it's a little bit more difficult to do, is you just add up every single path. So in other words, you could go from A, B to E to H, you go A, B, D, F, H, you go A, C, D, F, H, or A, C, G, H. This is a simple network, so there's really only a few different ways you can go. There's four different paths. What you need to do is find out which path is the longest path. The longest path, then, by definition, is the critical path because it's the longest amount of time required to get from the start to the finish. And anything shorter than that isn't really feasible because that is the one that is going to take you the longest. So I've highlighted it with the red arrows here. So the path is A, C, D, F, H, which in this case is like 30 weeks for these numbers. So you can also determine it some other ways, which I show you in the videos, doing the forward and backward pass, which is a later lecture. So let's say we have the critical path now. This is what we call the mean project duration. And assuming that's like a normal distribution. But remember, we don't really have a normal distribution. So what we also want to look at is what's the variances. So remember those variances we had to calculate. We can look at the total project variance through calculation. So that's something we'll look at in the next step. Then we're going to take the square root of the variance, calculate the standard deviation of the project. Once we have that, we'll determine a project target due date or the duration for the whole project. So, doesn't make sense unless you have an example. So, we just showed our critical path was 30 weeks. That becomes our mean of our normal distribution. However, we know there's variance in each and every activity. So, the way to get the variance for the total project is we have to sum up all those variances. So, it's the sum of the variances. So that's pretty simple. So if we know each and every activity and we've calculated all those variances, we add all those up, we get 7.72 in this scenario. Then we take the square root of that, and we get back to units. Because remember, a standard deviation is in the units of whatever the measurand is. In this case, it's weeks. So it gives us plus or minus 2.78 weeks is our standard deviation. So that means then we are at least, let's say we have a hard deadline from our customer, a due date of 31 weeks or some hard deadline that we have. Even though we calculated 30 weeks there, we have this variance that's pretty big. In fact, it's the difference between these two is a week. It's bigger than the 1 week, which means we might be in trouble of not being able to meet this 31-week deadline. How do we tell? We got to pull out a little bit of statistics. So we need to use the Z. So while we do that, we have to calculate the number of standard deviations the target duration lies from the mean. Here's where you want to use Appendix A. There's a Z table in there where you can look at the probability and look at the Z function to determine probability of success, or you can go the other way around. You can look at the Z function and determine the probability. So let me pause and I will bring up that chart. So the table, or any z table that you get, is from a cumulative standard normal distribution. What you're looking for is your estimate, does it give you at least a 95% or above probability of success? If it does not give you at least a 95% probability of success, then you need to probably adjust your estimate to at least give you a 95% confidence that you can finish in that time frame. How do we figure that out? Let's take a look. So again, we'll use the 95% probability. And if we need to, we can negotiate to get a calculated due date greater if there's a hard target. So again, the hard target was either something we self-imposed on ourselves, or maybe it's something that someone else gave to us, say it's a client or customer or the execs at a company. So we take the hard target, we subtract the value that we came up with on our critical path, and we divide by the overall project variance. This will give us our Z value. So we had 31 weeks minus 30 weeks divided by 2.78 weeks. We get a value of 0.36. So here, if we want to look at our diagram, we need to find out where that is. So 0.36, the z's are up here. You go down to where you see 0.3, and then this axis up here shows you your hundreds place, 0.6. So if you go down to both of those, where they crisscross, we have a value of 0.6406. This is the probability of success in decimal terms. So really, if you multiply by 100%, it really tells us we have a 64.06% chance of success. What does that mean? Well, that doesn't mean a good thing, actually. If that's our case, 64% probability that we're going to make that hard target is a little bit better than rolling dice, but not much. So in this scenario, we would actually want to increase our overall duration estimate. This is cutting it too close. Again, we want to have a probability of 95% or greater. So those are not good odds. What can we do? Well, we back calculate the opposite way. Say, you know what? Really, we want 95% confidence. So we want to calculate a new hard target based upon the mean that we have and the standard deviation that we have. So we need to reverse calculate by looking up a z value of 95% probability, multiply that times the standard deviation, and add that to our mean to calculate a new due date. Now, if you notice, this equation is really the same as this. It's just reorganized to solve for hard target. It's the same exact equation. So we're trying to get a new due date with a 95% confidence that we can achieve that due date. So again, because we want a z of 0.95, we go back to our table. Now we're doing a reverse lookup. So in this case, we need to go and back up to where we can have 0.95. So the probabilities are the numbers in here. So we're looking for where we have 0.95, we're really close there. Looks like the closest we have is either here or here. And really it's smack in the middle between these two. So if we have if we want to be at least 0.95, let's choose this one. So, because this is 0.95 or 95.05%, that gives us a z value of 1.6, and if you go up, 1.65. And if we took it to one more digit, 1.645 would be right in between these two, exactly, but that gives us enough. So 1.65. All right, so that is in fact what we put in here. So the z value of 1.65 times 2.78 plus 30 gives us a value of 34.59 weeks, which you could round that up to 35 weeks. And that would give you a much higher probability that you're going to finish this project on time. All right, so that is how you calculate both the estimates for each activity and also how you calculate the estimates for the overall project. Thank you, and I'll see you in class.